Okay. So, so in today's lecture, I will start to discuss more in detail this relation at the level of existence and uniqueness between the ODE viewpoint and the PDE viewpoint. Well, remind that for me, PDE mostly means the continuity equation, right? Okay, and I think I will start from a basic result. For simplicity, let me assume that the velocity is bounded. And I take, let's say, a Borel set A in Rn. And then we have this equivalence theorem. The following two properties are equivalent. First of all, this solutions to the ODE are unique for mu bar almost every initial point in A. And the second condition is that, let's say, for any initial measure nu less than mu bar, the PDE has a unique solution. Let's say for any initial measure, sorry, concentrated on A, the PDE has a unique solution. With initial condition. No. Okay? So actually, this theorem will not be the most useful for the applications, but because in some sense it's very difficult, and we already seen this in the square root example, that this is not the most natural notion of uniqueness. And in general, for instance, it's very difficult if you are out of a Cauchy-Lipschitz scenario, for instance, to prove that you have uniqueness or measure-valued solutions. But, well, maybe this is the first illustration of this kind of equivalence that one can take. And we will see that the proof of this involves a non-trivial fact, which is the superposition principle. And actually, this principle is very important, and it will play a role also in the rest of my lectures. Okay, so let me go from, of course, there is the trivial implication, which is from 2 to 1. Let's say that if we don't have uniqueness, so let's argue by contradiction, let's say that we have two distinct solutions. Solutions starting from the initial position, let's say, in A. And then, of course, we have seen that mu t equal to the Dirac mass at xt and mu tilde t equal to the Dirac mass at yt are solutions starting from the Dirac mass at x bar, right? So if uniqueness is violated at the level of DE, it is immediately violated at the level of the PDE. And so this is the IS implication. The non-trivial implication in this theorem is the other one, how to pass from the uniqueness at the ODE level to the uniqueness at the PDE level. And this requires a kind of way to represent the solution to the PDE in terms of solutions to the ODE without any regularity assumption on the vector field. And this is the superposition principle. Okay, now to illustrate the superposition principle, I need to fix some notation. Maybe I will denote by gamma t the space of continuous maps into Rn. And I will denote by Et the evaluation maps at time t. So Ct of gamma is simply gamma of t. Okay? Okay, given this notation, what I'm going to consider is this idea of superposition. So to make formal this idea of superposition, I'm going to consider probability measures eta, which are, well, this is a bit redundant as a presentation, but I think it's more intuitive. I will consider probability measures in the product Rn cross gamma t, right? Where the first factor is a kind of label for the initial position of the trajectory, concentrated on pairs x gamma, where, as I said, x is a label for the initial position, so gamma of 0 is equal to x, and gamma solves the ODE. Okay? So in principle, given, since I am allowing a priori also non-uniqueness, in principle, given an initial position, I might have many different gammas. And I formalize this idea by considering a suitable weight in the space of possible solutions, which is my eta. And then, given eta, I can define mu t eta simply as the marginal of eta at time t, right? So, well, sometimes I will consider t also as a map defined on this product. So explicitly, this means that the integral of phi d mu eta t is equal to the integral of phi of gamma t d eta x gamma. Okay. And then I have this result. I will call this a superposition solution. Called the superposition induced by eta. Okay? So why I'm saying that mu t is a superposition solution? Because the very same computation that we saw yesterday, so yesterday we saw that if we have a unique trajectory, right? And we push forward with this unique trajectory, some initial measure mu bar, then mu t solves the continuity equation. But actually, the same phenomenon, more or less with the same computation, occurs when you have many trajectories, right? Provided, of course, all these trajectories are solutions to the ODE, which is what I'm doing. I am assuming that theta is concentrated on pairs x gamma for which gamma is a solution. And so, basically, by the same computation that I will not repeat, one can prove that mu t eta d over dt plus the divergence of bt mu eta t is equal to 0. Okay, the superposition principle precisely goes in the other direction, answers the opposite question. So if I am given a solution to the continuity equation, can I lift this solution to a probability? And the answer is yes. So let me state now the precise result. A theorem. Let's say, let us assume this integrability condition, which also appeared yesterday. And I have, let's say, a family of probability measures, which provides a weak solution. Then there exists an eta, precisely as I erased before, right? A probability measure concentrated on pair 6 gamma, for which gamma solves the ODE. Well, first of all, I have to add also this condition, which is not totally trivial. Yeah, okay, I was assuming already that the total mass is 1, but actually this really is a consequence of these two conditions. Okay, let me write in this way. You have positive finite measures, then one can prove that mu t, let's say with mu 0 over n equal to 1, then a consequence of this condition is that the total mass is conserved and mu t precisely is representable as mu t eta for some eta. Okay? Okay, now then I will give you a short sketch of proof of this theorem. Let's see how, with this theorem, we can reverse the implication. Why? How we can prove that from the uniqueness of the ODE, we can pass to the uniqueness of the PDE. Well, we can represent mu t as mu t eta. But then I can also disintegrate eta, right? Let's say the integral of phi okay, let me write it in this way. I can write eta equal to the integral of eta x, the mu bar of x, where eta x now will be really probability measures on gamma t, which are concentrated on the solutions to the ODE starting from x. Okay? But now I am assuming, my assumption one is that for mu bar almost every x, there is a unique solution starting from x, right? So this tells me that eta x is equal to the Dirac mass at delta xt, where is the unique solution by assumption. And so you see that under this assumption, there is no freedom on eta. There is only one eta. And so this means that a posteriori, we really get the classical formula, right? Where this is precisely the unique solution appearing here, okay? So with this statement, you see that we can go in some sense back and forth between the Eulerian and the Lagrangian description. Okay, now a few words about the proof of this theorem. Proof is pretty long, so I will just give a short sketch. Well, first of all, we can mollify. Well, first of all, I can find the function theta by Danforth-Petty's theorem. Where theta goes to infinity more than linearly. Okay, this is just Danforth-Petty. So any L1 function is slightly more than L1. And now the strategy is to mollify. And I have to be careful not to introduce singularities. I will mollify with the kernel whose support is equal to Rn. For instance, you can take a Gaussian mollification kernel. Why? Because if I do this, I can define a kind of regularized vector field in this way. So B epsilon will be B mu T star rho epsilon over mu T star rho epsilon. So instead of mollifying the vector field, in some sense I mollify the flux in the continuity equation. Why this definition is convenient? Because with this definition I retain the structure of the continuity equation. So B epsilon T is defined precisely in a way that is equal to zero, okay? And of course, this assumption is useful because it tells me that this is always positive, and so this formula makes sense. The price I pay is that only B epsilon will not be very smooth, but only locally Lipschitz. So a priori, there is this problem that the ODE associated to B epsilon T might have blow up in finite time because it's only locally Lipschitz. Well, on the other hand, I know that there is a density globally transported by this velocity. And this is the remark I made yesterday about the Cauchy-Lipschitz theory. Under this condition, one can show that the maximal solutions associated to B epsilon T is defined for mu epsilon zero almost every x. And moreover, I can represent mu epsilon T as mu epsilon zero, okay? And now the strategy is to try to pass to the limit in this formula. And of course, since I have no strong control on these trajectories, which in limit might oscillate very much, and they do oscillate in some examples, I take the limit in the sense of probabilities. Okay, let me do this in a more rigorous way. Now I define what is the approximation of beta. And of course, the idea here comes from the theory of L.C. Young. Yeah, maybe I open a little parenthesis about this in the context of optimal transport, of course, is the idea of Kantorovich. So you have, let's say you have a family of maps from X to Y, and you have a priori no strong compactness for these families of maps. You have some measure mu, let's say some fixed measure, for instance, mu in X. And then we will see also in many other occasions a natural way to take limits, and which is really the point of view of S. E. Young, is to associate to the function and to this measure a measure in the product. So this will be the graph of FH, and my measure, let me call this measure theta H, will be the identity cross FH, the axis of mu. Okay, let me allow also mu to depend a priori on H, as it happens here, okay? So in general, so I'm really pushing my measure mu h from the basis x to a measure which lives on the graph. And in general, of course, when this fh oscillates wildly, in general, I will get a measure in the limit. Then I can take a limiting measure up to subsequences. And of course, if these functions oscillate a lot, in the limit, this will not be a measure concentrated on a graph. Okay? This is the basic idea of S. E. Young and Kantorovich. And here we do precisely the same thing. So my map here will be this map. So considering the map which associates to X, or to be more precise, since I'm working on the product, okay, so this will be a map from Rn to Rn cross gamma t. And then I'm pushing forward my measures mu epsilon via this map, and I define my probability measure eta epsilon in this product, which of course is concentrated on solutions relative to B epsilon, which are unique also. And then mu epsilon is equal precisely to mu eta epsilon T. So, of course, mu epsilon is associated to this eta epsilon. And then now one takes the limit. So this is the first step. So in this first step, we have built our approximation. Then there is the second step, which is a tightness argument. So one can consider the functional psi of x gamma, which is plus infinity if gamma 0 is different from x. And psi of x plus the integral between 0 and t on theta gamma dot dt, where psi is a function, again, is a coercive function. With okay, so since the family of measures at time zero arise from the convolution with a given measure, I can find some function which goes to infinity as x goes to infinity with this property. And then I use this function of x and the function theta, which controls the velocities, to build this auxiliary function on Rn from times gamma t. So psi is from Rn cross gamma t into 0 plus infinity. And this is coercive. This is a coercive function. Which means that, of course, the sublevel sets are compact in Rn cross gamma t. This is just Ascoli-Arzelà theorem. OK, and then one can check, by the way I define this function, that the integral of psi, capital psi, d eta epsilon is bounded. And this means, by standard compactness theorems in the space of probabilities, that I can find some subsequence, eta epsilon I, which is weakly convergent to some meta. Okay? Eventually, I would like to pass to the limit in this formula. This is pretty easy if you go to the definition. Of course, in the right-hand side, mu epsilon is a convolution, so clearly converges to mu t. But also, if you look also to the definition of superposition measure, also it is clear that if eta epsilon I converges to eta, this converges to mu eta t. The most difficult part of the proof is to show that in the limit, so the missing part now for the proof is that to show that in the limit, eta is concentrated on solutions to the ODE. So why this is more difficult? Because, of course, our velocity, I'm not making any continuity assumption on the velocity. And, of course, with weak convergence, you can only test against continuous functions. But here, we can use the specific form of the approximation to bypass this difficulty. I will not give any detail about this. If you're interested, you can find it in my lecture notes. And so with this final and more technical part, we have a complete proof of the superposition. Okay, now let me go back to this equivalence that I was discussing. So as I said, we have say uniqueness for let's say for all this bar in A. This is equivalent to uniqueness for solutions to the PDE, to the continuity equation starting from, let's say, measure nu concentrated on A. As I said, this criterion is difficult to apply in many situations because it's not easy out of the Cauchy-Lipschitz scenario to check, for instance, this condition. So now the natural question is, what happens if we have a uniqueness for the continuity equation, not in the class of measure-valued solutions, but in smaller classes of solutions? And in particular, I will focus on this class, but many other choices are possible, and indeed one can also make an abstract theory out of this. But let me focus in this class, which I will denote by L, which is the class of L infinity functions as a function of time with values in L1 intersection L infinity. And I only consider non-negative functions. Okay. So let us assume that for our PDE, for the continuity equation, maybe now I can start using also u, because now these will be functions. Let's say that for our PDE, we are able to prove uniqueness of solutions in this class, so which is a weaker statement. It is natural to expect that then we should have a parallel uniqueness statement for a weaker notion. We should have a weaker notion of uniqueness. And this is, in fact, true. And this leads to the concept of regular flow. So let me give you now the basic definition of the theory. So, as usual, I have a vector field. And then I say, and I have a family of maps which, keeping in mind the first example I gave of the square root, you should think as a kind of selection of trajectories, right? A selection of solutions. Then we say that X is a regular flow. Of course, relative to B, if, well, first of all, of course, I'm saying that is an absolutely continuous solutions to the ODE in 0t. Of course, with the x0x equal x for almost every x, for Lebesgue almost every x. I'm working here as with the reference measure, Lebesgue measure. And then if you remind the example, again, of the square root, we need to single out, as I said, a good class of trajectories which avoid the singularities. We need this non-concentration condition, which says this, that if I push forward the Lebesgue measure with this family of trajectories, the densities, these measures should be absolutely continuous, but not only. Here we need a quantitative condition. The density should be bounded with respect to Lebesgue measure. And of course, this constant should be independent of time. Okay, I call this regular flow. And then the theorem that I would like to illustrate today, maybe today I will not be able to complete the proof, is this theorem. Which provides the implication from 2 to 1, the useful implication from 2 to 1, assume well, first of all, we need a growth condition. Well, the typical growth condition of the DiPerna and Lions theory is which is assessed dual to the condition on the densities. And that the continuity equation has uniqueness. I don't care at this moment for about existence. We will talk about existence later on. Now I'm focusing only on uniqueness. So as uniqueness of solutions, if you restrict yourself to this class L. And then at the ODE level, the statement is that there is at most one, one Lagrangian flow. So what I mean more precisely by uniqueness, I mean that if you have two families of trajectories which satisfy this property, this means that for almost every x. So uniqueness in the sense of pathwise uniqueness, okay? Very well. So, and now I will start to give some, well, maybe it's better before giving us the proof to give some examples of vector fields for which this implication is known and is useful. And then we start with some ideas of the proof. Well, there are many classes of vector fields for which actually it is maybe the only way to prove uniqueness of the ODE is to pass through the uniqueness at the PDE level. And well, the first example comes with the work of DiPerna and Lions. So besides this condition, if you add the condition that the divergence of B is L1 L infinity, and that BT is L1 with values in W11 lock, I think we will see in tomorrow's lecture that under these assumptions, under these two conditions, you see this is kind of global condition on the divergence, a local regularity condition in space. One can prove that uniqueness, there is a uniqueness of solutions, and then a posteriori there is a unique flow. So this is the first example, the Sobolev case. Another result of mine is when you require, instead of Sobolev, you require BV. And then, let's say, still with this growth condition. And you require that, however, that the divergence, of course, for a BV function, now the divergence will be a measure in general, but we need to require for my result that the divergence is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. And also we need a quantitative bound on the negative part. As we saw yesterday in the Cauchy, already in the Cauchy-Lipschitz theory, the growth of the solution is controlled by the negative part of the divergence. This explains why in this theorem we need the quantitative condition only on the negative part. So again, this is L1 L infinity. But there are many other examples. And for instance, another very important example which occurs in the linearization of this theory, was discovered by Lebris and Lyons, are vector fields. So now I'm going to illustrate vector fields which have a special structure, and this special structure compensates for lack of regularity to some extent. And this is a vector field, let's say, in a kind of phase space, which is B of X, nabla B of X, B. Okay? Where B is Sobolev again. And what happens? It happens, however, that if you look at the vector field capital B is regular in the first components, but extremely irregular a priori in the last components as functions of X, right? On the other hand, this vector field has a very special structure for which it is still possible to prove this kind of statement. And then there is a unique flow, and the flow associated to this vector field is really the linearized flow of associated to B. And a final example I would like to make, which I think will appear also in the lectures by Alessio, is appears in connection with the theory of Vlasov-Poisson. Again, this is a vector field with a very special structure because, I mean, like if you remember yesterday, the equation I wrote, in the case of the Vlasov-Poisson, the vector field has this structure. Again, we are in a kind of phase space. In the first components, we are extremely irregular. And in the last components, we have a function E of X, where E is generated by convolution even with the measure. So this goes, in a sense, goes beyond BV, beyond Sobolev, right? And this is a particularly interesting example because this is not covered. This is not covered by this technique. And there is another technique which allows to attack this kind of vector fields, but for instance, which does not allow to attack the BV vector fields. And there is another direction which I think Alessio will briefly illustrate, which is the theory of quantitative ODE estimates. And anyhow, even though eventually this vector field can be attacked by a different technique, so not using this result, still the basic concept is this one. Eventually, the object which is identified by the theory is precisely the unique object, is precisely the regular flow. Okay. So this is just to provide some motivation for this kind of result. Well. Okay, so let me start now to give a part at least of the proof, and I think I will complete the proof tomorrow. Okay, today I will start with first of all, we start with an elementary remark and the lemma, and then I will state the main result. And eventually, in the end, I will prove the theorem. Okay, first of all, let's say an elementary observation. So eventually we want to detect when a measure in gamma t is a Dirac mass. So first elementary observation is that, let's say, sigma is a Dirac mass if and only if it PDSs of sigma is a Dirac mass in our n for a countable dense set of time, for a dense set of times. Okay, this is elementary just because the trajectories are continuous. So if you fix the value of the trajectory on a continuous set of, on a dense set of times, then you fix the trajectory. Okay? And then the lemma I will need is a kind of orthogonality lemma. So I want a criterion which tells me that a whole family of measures is a Dirac mass, is made by Dirac masses. So let me call this orthogonality lemma. Which says the following. So assume that we have a family in P of gamma T with this property. For any time in 0t, and for any disjoint Borel sets one is that so it says that x are mutually orthogonal in this sense, that is equal to zero for almost every x. Okay? Then, okay, maybe I erase here. Then eta x is a Dirac mass for almost every x. Okay? So let's give the proof of this fact. Well, first of all, I can use this remark. To check that some measure is a Dirac mass, I need only to check at some time t, and I use a density argument. So it is sufficient to show, so fix t and define let's say lambda x equal to ETDSs of eta x. And then our assumption becomes, now t is fixed, that lambda x of e times lambda x of e prime is equal to zero for almost every x whenever e and e prime are disjoint. Okay? And now we need only to check out of this condition. We would like to prove that now, so lambda x now will be probability measures, of course, in R n. with this claim, I would like to prove that lambda x is a Dirac mass for almost every x. But the proof is here is elementary. I just do a decomposition of Rn. So for any, let's say, for any delta, divide Rn in a partition with, let's say, Ri with the diameter of Ri less than delta. And then you have the property that the lambda x of Ri times lambda x of Rj is equal to zero almost everywhere, whenever I is different from j. And of course, this implies that for almost every x, there is a unique I such that, say, the support of lambda x is contained in the closure over Ri. Right? Let's say there exists some I because the boundaries might overlap. And then since delta is arbitrary, this tells me that for almost every x, lambda x is a Dirac mass. Okay? Okay, now how I'm going to use this lemma? I'm going to use this lemma to prove this statement. So let us assume that so theorem. So assume that we have uniqueness. We have uniqueness of the continuity equation. And let's take, as usual, a probability measure P on Rn cross gamma T concentrated on, let's say, good pairs X gamma. Of course, by good pairs, I mean solutions to the ODE starting at zero from X. Okay. And with mu t, and this is the crucial assumption, that mu t eta, so if I look to the continuity equation induced by eta, I need to know that I am in the good class where I have uniqueness, which, remember, is L1 intersection L infinity. And of course, the strongest condition is L1 is not a particularly strong requirements because I'm thinking about probability densities. The strong condition is that I'm requiring that the densities should be uniformly bounded, right? By saying that mu t eta belongs to L, I'm saying that the densities should be uniformly bounded. Then, writing eta x, eta equal to integral of eta x dx, one has that eta x is a graph, is a Dirac mass for, let's say, okay, maybe I will denote by mu bar the first marginal of eta, the marginal of on Rd of eta for mu bar almost every x. Okay? And this is exactly the way in which I can transfer the uniqueness property, in some sense, from the continuity equation to probability measures concentrated on solution. I'm saying that when I disintegrate theta, I find only Dirac masses. Okay, the heuristic idea of the proof is somehow simple, but then this the real implementation requires really all these technicalities. So first, maybe I give you the heuristic idea, and then as I proceed, I think I will be able today to complete this proof. Well, of course, the heuristic idea is very simple. Assume for simplicity that delta x is, let's say, 1/2 times the Dirac mass plus the Dirac mass, and that at some time, in a set of positive measure of x, for some time, depending on x, these two trajectories are different. It is clear that selecting, for instance, only these trajectories, or selecting only these trajectories, I can build two distinct solutions to the continuity equation, starting from the same initial measure. So I can violate the uniqueness at the level of the continuity equation. The proof, of course, is more complicated because, in general, I don't know that theta x have this simple structure. And, of course, I have to take care to select the trajectories in such a way to create a bounded density, right? Because I have uniqueness of the continuity equation only in the class of bounded densities. So I can't simply select the trajectories at random because I could create a too concentrated solution. Okay, so now let's see how the real proof works on the basis of this heuristic idea. Okay, let us assume that the thesis is false, and then I can apply the criterion stated before. So if eta x is not a Dirac mass in a set of positive measure, I mean that I can find a positive time, and I can find disjoint Borel sets let's say by the lemma. Such that let's say I can also find a set of initial points that I will call C with a positive measure, okay? Such that precisely the product which was appearing in the lemma prime, this is positive for any x in C. Okay? Just this is the negation of the assumption of the lemma. And then, possibly passing to a smaller set C, with still with positive measure, this quantity is pointwise positive, but passing eventually possibly to a smaller set. Let me assume also that this product is less than some constant m, independent of x. Okay? This is not restrictive. So, okay, let me write in this way, maybe. Maybe I will call this ratio beta of x, let's say, I will call this ratio beta of x. Okay, now the idea is to select precisely the trajectories that at time t are in E, and the trajectories that at time t are in E prime. Since E and E prime are disjoint, in this way I should produce measures which at the time t are orthogonal, right? And so this is what I do. So now I define eta 1 x equal to the characteristic function of C. This means that I select only initial points which are in C. I don't care about the other points, times the characteristic function of all trajectories gamma, which are in E, times eta. And analogously, I define eta 2x. I put a beta before. Again, I'm selecting only points in C. And I'm taking the characteristic functions of all gamma, such that gamma t is in E prime times eta. Okay, this is precisely this operation of selecting trajectories in a careful way. And then I call mu 1 t the solution to the continuity equation induced by by eta 1. Eta 1, of course, will be the integral of eta 1 x d mu bar x. And analogously, I will call mu 2 t eta 2 . Okay, what happens? Well, I have chosen beta in such a way that these two measures, since I multiplied precisely by this ratio, these two measures are equal at time zero. Okay. Then I can also say that mu I t belongs to L. So the densities are still bounded. Why? Well, at this level it's clear because I'm choosing less trajectories and I'm multiplying by a characteristic function. At this level it's still true because I am assuming that beta is bounded, right? So I have two solutions to the continuity equation starting from the same initial condition. And by construction, mu 1 t is concentrated on E, while mu 2 t is concentrated on E prime, right? And this violates the uniqueness at the level of the continuity equation. And so this completes the proof of the result. Okay, and now out of this we can almost immediately get the uniqueness of the Lagrangian flow. The existence we will see tomorrow is much simpler once we have this kind of structural results. So let me just say how we can prove uniqueness. Say corollary. Uniqueness of solutions. Well, this is actually the theorem I already stated, but let me now state as a corollary of this result. Uniqueness of solutions to the continuity equation in L implies uniqueness of the Lagrangian flow. But this is immediate because any Lagrangian flow induces canonically. So if X is any Lagrangian flow, it induces canonically in a probability measure eta in the usual way. So eta will be identity bar, so I fix, let's say, a reference measure rho an initial measure rho in L1 intersection L infinity, non negative. And so canonically any Lagrangian flow induces a probability measure eta. So let us assume that you have two Lagrangian flows. And you can mix. You can mix the two, of course. So you can mix this construction, which means that extending this construction, you can define eta, which is the integral of 1/2 the Dirac mass plus the Dirac mass okay. And this will be a measure concentrated on solutions to the ordinary differential equation starting at x. We know by the previous theorem that, however, any of these measures should be concentrated on a graph. But if x and y differ in a set of positive measures, this measure will be concentrated only on a multivariate graph, right? So from the graph property, we get basically the uniqueness. And this is the uniqueness part. Okay. And okay, I think for today we can stop here. And tomorrow we will start to discuss very briefly how the existence comes of the regular flow. And we will say also a few words about besides uniqueness, we have also natural stability results for this concept. Okay, and I stop here. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions?